on News Talk 1400 and 92.3 WOMD with your host, Blake Rozelle.
And welcome back here to another week on the Big Man's Report Live on News Talk 1400 and 92.3 WOND. I am your host, Blake Rozelle. Thank you all for coming on for another week here with me on the Big Man's Report. I hope you guys are all having a lovely week. And like I always do, I do the weather check. And Scott in there always helps me with the weather check. Scott, what are we thinking out there today? Nice or what?
It is nice tonight. Yeah, we've got for the ocean water temperature, 72 degrees. Right here at the studios at Longport Media in Linwood, 85 degrees under sunny skies. And on that world-famous boardwalk in Atlantic City, there is sunshine, and it is 83. Nice night for a walk on the boardwalk.
Scott, they're going to think you're going to be a meteorologist. That sounded really good. Well, thank you all for coming on again tonight. We're having some beautiful weather here today at the Jersey Shore. Last week, if you had a chance to catch my interview with Susan Bacharach of Core Power Bar in Margate, New Jersey, over the bridge, she was in studio. We had a wonderful conversation about how she, her passion, how she got into, core fitness, right? And core, and I didn't really know much about Core Power Bar until she kind of walked me through the steps. And, you know, it's a lot different than actual fitness training with weights and machines. But she was terrific and in guiding me and guiding my audience on what Core Power Bar is. And, we had a lovely conversation, like I said, and, if you're interested, in taking classes with Susan, I highly recommend you try it out because she is terrific at what she does and she's passionate. And she's an ace in her and an expertise in her field. So contact Susan on her website, corepowerbar.com, or you can find her Instagram at corepowerbarmargate. And you know, send her a direct message and you know, she will get back to you with signing up for a class and all your needs and go forward from there. So try around one of her classes because they're terrific. I'd love to have her on again in the future. We're scheduling something in a few weeks to do actually a live shot from her studio over in Margate. And that should be a great interview. So I'm looking forward to that as well. In just a few short seconds here, I'm going to introduce my guest this evening. This gentleman is big in acting all over the country. He shot some great films, and you may have recognized a lot of films he's been in. We've had some great conversations throughout the past couple months about his life and him growing up and how he got into acting. And I want you guys to all hear that tonight here on the air. And we're going to talk a little bit about, you know, where he grew up and how he got into his acting and all the movies he's been in and some things he's working on, you know, going forward and some other things that he's involved in as well. And you definitely see him on the big screen. But without further ado, I'd like to introduce my main man, Sonny Marinelli. Sonny, thank you for coming on tonight.
Hey, Blake, how are you?
I'm doing well. So I know you're down in Florida, so it kind of beats New Jersey's weather. Is that true?
Yeah, I just moved here. excuse me. The business has changed in L.A., you know, so we can audition from anywhere we want. Now we're doing all self-tapes at home because with COVID, everyone closed down their offices. So it works out wonderfully for me because I always wanted to come down here. So now I can live here and audition from my apartment. So it's great. I love it down here. I love the heat.
Yeah,
people hate me for it.
You can't
people hate that. Me for it.
Well, you know what? People, I mean, you know, how's the humidity? The humidity down in Florida's got to be pretty bad too, right? It's just like New Jersey. I remember when I've been there years back, the humidity really takes over down there. Is that true?
Yeah, I mean, summer here is, you know, it's hot, but I mean, I remember, you know, growing up in New York my whole life, it was July and August, it's humid, hot, day, night. And you know, when I was a kid years and years and years and years ago, you know, we didn't have air conditioning. So, I remember my mother would like get like cold water from the refrigerator and spray the sheets and the pillow because it was so hot. Yeah. But now I'm a big shot and I have central air conditioning, so I'm very comfortable at night.
So you must feel good when you're sleeping at night in the central.
Oh my God. Oh, it's fantastic. Yeah. I love it.
Well, I wanted to thank you for coming on tonight, and we're going to talk about a lot about your career and a lot of different pictures that you appeared in, some things that maybe you're working on going mm-hmm. forward in your career. But we'll talk a little about the acting business, the acting world. I know some of us, I mean, we have a lot of mutual friends in common, some people that you've worked with that I've had on my show. And, you know, shout out some of those guys that we'll mention in some time here in the interview. But I always like to start out talking about, you know, the background. Like, we always want to know, what is the background into how you got started, right? And we always talk about the childhood because the upbringing is important and how you kind of got to where you got to, because as a young kid, young child, we never really know what we want to do and what direction we want to go in life, right? So you grew up in New York City, and tell us, my audience, a little bit more about that and growing up in New York.
Yeah, I grew up in my childhood I spent in Brooklyn. I was just a really, really shy kid. And went to high school. We moved to Staten Island when I was in high school. And I played football since I was, you know, 6, 7 years old. And that's what I wanted to do with my life, play ball. I had, you know, dreams of being an NFL player like every other kid. And I got sidetracked because I got hurt my senior year, and my career was over. And I started to wander. I didn't go to college. I didn't know what I wanted to do. I had all these manual labor jobs, terrible jobs. And I was about 20 or 21, and I was working on the docks in Brooklyn. And I remember looking and seeing guys that are like in their 40s back then, which seemed really old, in 50s. And they just looked beat up and tired, you know, working in 8 degrees. And I said, I can't do this my whole life. No way I'm going to make 2 years, let alone 40. And I always played with the idea of being an actor. So I just, I had new, you know, my family wasn't involved. And I said, you know what, let me look in the yellow pages, believe it or not. I was at work, and let me just gander, you know, take a gander at the yellow pages back then. We didn't have Google back then. And I stumbled across a school called the American Academy of Dramatic Arts. I didn't know it was this old, really prestigious school. And I started at night. I had audition. I started at night, but you know what, Blake, from the first, I didn't like school. I always felt confined and antsy, and I didn't like authority. But from the first day I entered that school, I was hooked. I was just so hot for it. And that was it, man. I quit the job. I sold my car. I moved to Manhattan. That was the big thing back then. You had to live in the city if you wanted to be an actor, you know? And that was it. I never looked back. My career has been a roller coaster, like a lot of actors, up and down, but I've never look back, and it saved me, because, you know, I was hanging out with some folks that were getting in some trouble. Right. I was also. And at that age, you know, teenager, you can get in trouble and it's fun, and maybe you get, you know, slap on the wrist from the cops. But at 20, 21, that's when you're in the major leagues.
Yeah.
And I got away from all that, and that was it, man. I was just hooked. I finally found something aside from football that I really loved. And in a weird way, sports and acting, even though one's physical and one is emotional, they for me, it was similar. It was similar because I had to escape who I was to be an aggressive football player because I was a shy kid. And the same thing as an actor. You have to escape. You have a license to escape your normal life, you know, your normal personality. You have a chance to let out all these emotions and feelings and characters that you always wanted to play with, but I was too afraid to because I was right. So shy. So it was great.
And that's the beauty too in acting, which you made a great point about how you can kind of come out of your shell in acting. You know, I hear a lot of stories about how some actors are, you know, the same that what they are on camera is what they are off the, you know, off camera. And then a lot of actors, they put on a different character, obviously, for the cameras, but then off the camera, they're a completely different person. I mean, does that really go true? Or do you see that big in the acting field, kind of like what you were saying a little bit?
Oh, yeah, 100%. 100%. You really have to. Whether you're shy or whether you're, you know, Bill Murray, you have to absorb some other personality. And for me, yeah, because I was so damn shy. And I always wanted to express myself. I wanted to talk up, but I was afraid. And in a crowd, I would just shut down. At dinner, I would just shut down if there were 10, 15 people. And I wanted to speak up, but I was so afraid. Well, now I had a chance. It was actually my job. I had to speak up.
Yeah.
So it was all this energy from my whole life, my whole childhood, just exploding when action was called out. You know, action, boom, and it all came out. It just felt so good. You know, I played as a teenager, like we all did, with a couple of hallucinogens and whatnot, but there's nothing, for me, there was nothing like it. And there's still nothing like it. Nothing like, you know, my life between action and cut, honestly.
Yeah. And like you said, too, it gives you a chance to come out of your shell and everything that you've wanted, you had built up and you've wanted to kind of experience and you wanted to say, you know, when you hear that action, it kind of gives you that freedom to do that. And I'm sure at first, were you kind of a little nervous behind the camera, or you kind of just jumped right in there and you, when you were casting or during your first shoot? I mean, how did you feel in your first, in your, well, your first camera?
I started doing theater, doing a lot of plays, and that was terrifying. In fact, my first play in New York, I was, you know, off Broadway, but I was the lead in the play, and I was first on, and I was on stage the whole time, and I was terrified, and I had no idea what I was doing. I just wanted to remember my lines and go home, you know, because I was so frightened. But when I finished, I couldn't believe I did it. You know, I couldn't actually believe I did it, and you know, it's like a boxer gets in the ring the first time, he's terrified. But after the third, fourth fight, you know, gets used to getting hit. And, you know, with theater, it's the same thing. Like night after night after night, you start getting comfortable out there. Film, I don't know. I like film. A lot of actors like theater. I love film and TV because it's so intimate, because there's no audience, just people working around you. And it's much quieter. It's a lot more quiet. And yeah, I was, you know, hearing a director yell out action and know you have to go at that moment, it's sort of like, you know, like being on, you know, a scrimmage line of football and, you know, on two, hut, hut, and go. And it's frightening. But you have no choice, or you get fired. And I knew that. And it's breaking down these fear barriers that were great for me. You know, understand, looking back, go, wow, I actually did that. And I'm still nervous, Blake. I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm doing this 30 years now, and I walk on set the first day, and I'm shaking. I'm nervous. And the truth is, I never want to lose that, because I think when you get too complacent, you don't care, and it shows in your work. I think you have to have – your stomach needs to be moving around a little bit. Your fingers need to be shaking a little bit when you walk onto set, because that's where, like, the magic happens, you know? Right. I'm not terrified anymore, thank goodness. But yeah, it's frightening, you know, especially when you're working with really great actors and you have a really well-known director. It's frightening.
Yeah. And that's really cool to hear, because, like, especially when you're younger, you know, and you're growing up, you're watching movies, you're watching, you know, you're watching different things on TV, on television. And then now you have the chance to kind of unfold your talents. Right. And you're probably working with some great actors, like you said, who have had a big name on the screen for years, or and big time directors. Mm-hmm. I you know, and I'm sure you've came across many big names and met a lot of people in the acting world that you've developed relationships with, who maybe kind of guided you or kind of gave you that that access to, mm-hmm. you know, not giving you good knowledge on acting. But that's got to be a really neat experience too. I mean, tell me a little bit about some of the great actors that you had a chance to work with. Maybe some of your favorite pictures that you worked in. What are some things that you really, you know, that you admire in those actors?
I'll mention three names, and these are three gurus who, thank God, I met them early in my career, because they became incredibly good friends and they guided me early on. And one is Bobby Moresco. He's a writer director. He was co-wrote Crash, won an Academy Award for that, and directed me in a movie called Tenth and Wolf. I was a member of his theater company, and man, he, you know, he let me have it. He wasn't easy on me, and he really guided me early on. And Chaz Palminteri, I did two movies with Chaz, and we became very good friends. And he just, I don't know, he just, on the first movie, he took to me and guided me through the movie, gave me tips that they could not teach you in acting school. Right. You know, you need experience on film, like Chaz is a great actor. And man, he would come over my apartment recently, about a year ago, he came over and did this acting exercise with me because I was struggling. I was about to do this role, and he sat down with me in my apartment, you know, guy's a big movie star, and worked out this really great acting exercise for me. And it saved me on the movie I was doing. And he's a wonderful, generous actor. And the third I'm going to mention last, because he just passed away, dear, dear man, God, what an incredible actor, Mark Margolis, just passed away a few days ago. And you know, he was the old man in Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul with the Bell.
Yeah.
And he's been in everything. He was in Scarface. And I did two movies with Mark. And he's an old theater guy, Mark. And in very kind words, he would tell me, "You're stinking up the place, Sonny. You know, you're stinking up the place. You're admiring." Remember, he told me one time, "You're admiring your work too much." In other words, like a boxer, when he starts throwing like fancy jabs, and that's when he gets knocked out because he's admiring his style. And I was, because I started to work a lot at that point, and people were telling me I had some talent, and I started to admire my own work. And Mark told me, "You're admiring your own work, and basically you're stinking up the fucking, you're stinking up the place." Excuse my language. That's what he said. It wasn't my word. He said effing place. So, and he really told me some wonderful stories. And like I said before, how I get, I'm still nervous. Mark told me, and at the time he was probably 70. He said, "Sonny, I still think I'm going to get fired on every job I have. That's how nervous I get." So God, to hear a guy like that has been around for so many years, it's priceless to get three guys like that. And there are many more, but those three guys were gold for me.
Right. And that's great too. I mean, Chaz Palminteri, I mean, the movies that he's obviously been in. I mean, we know The Bronx Tale, and we know a lot of great movies. I mean, some of the funny ones, Analyze This, Analyze That. He must have been awesome to be able to work with him. And I know he does a podcast now. He's got a big podcast on YouTube, and he brings on a lot of actors and different people in the acting and comedy world. But that's great for you that you had the chance to be able to meet obviously, as you work your way up in your career, you're going to meet these wonderful actors and these wonderful people. And I've heard a lot of great stories too about how they guide you in a way. And I'm sure you were saying a lot of them gave you good advice, right? And we have a couple short minutes here before we go to commercial break. But was there a certain individual that you looked up to as a young kid, or someone that you really admired, whether it was family or somebody on the big screens, that, hey, I want to be like that person, or this person's kind of going to give me the fuel to drive me forward? Did you have someone like that in your life growing up?
I mean, I think every kid, of course, when I got older, it was De Niro and Pacino, but every kid, I mean, I was a little kid watching Brando movies with my dad, and I just couldn't believe who this man was. I thought he was a god, you know, and I knew nothing about acting. I had no interest in being an actor back then, but I remember watching Brando movies and thinking, my God, I wish I was that good looking. And I, even as a young kid, I understood that he was doing something odd on screen. He wasn't doing the stuff other actors were doing, but I had no clue. Of course, I was a kid. But and then when I went to acting school, I started to study Brando. Until today, I mean, of course, I admire him more than ever. What he did on that screen was just, I don't know, I can't even describe it. When I try to, I don't even know what he was doing. It was so incredible. Up until even Apocalypse Now, it's just magical, you know. If I can be, you know, 1/10 of that, I'd be happy in my career having that kind of talent.
Yeah, I mean, hats off to some of these guys. I mean, Marlon Brando was one of the original, or would they say OGs, they would say, right, in the acting world. And he was terrific, and some unbelievable pictures that he appeared in, some great films. But one of the biggest things about the acting world, I feel like, is it's not easy, as you would know. And I know what they say, like what it looks like is you go on a set, you shoot a couple scenes, and then you're, you know, but the acting process and being an actor and all the long days and shooting a movie are tiresome and they're not easy. And we're, you know, we'll go to break in a minute here, but when we get back, I want to talk a little bit about some of the long days and shooting a film and what goes into that. And is there ways you have to mentally prepare, physically prepare for a day on the set? And we're going to talk about that when we get back here on News Talk 1400 and 92.3 WOND. I am your host, Blake Rozelle. Do not go anywhere. We'll be right back.
News Talk 1400 and 92.3 WOND is everywhere you are. Listen on your smartphone, computer, or tablet. Go to WOND.
Sonny, can you hear me?
For more.
Yeah.
News Talk 1400 and 92.3 WOND. South Jersey.
You all right so far?
I'm great, man. Great questions. Good.
Cool.
Really good questions.
Huh?
Really good questions.
I appreciate it. Yeah, I just the since we're on the air live, the curse words or whatever. I should have told you before. That's my fault. But don't worry. Yeah, no, it's all right.
I said fuck. We're good. I said fuck. Fuck. I didn't say the TK.
Country and Western comedy.
No, I don't care. It's the news. It's the FCC.
Well, you know what Mark told me? Star. He said this you're stinking up Bob, the fucking place.
Banjo Bob for the Jim Crane.
You got to be real. That's what he said. He didn't say F, but he said real place.
Just for the fun of it.
At least six people are dead in the hurricane field.
We'll go back on Maui. In like two or three minutes, I'm going to read my sponsors, right? And then we'll go
I'm going to put myself on mute.
The tourists are being told to leave and to postpone travel to the island. FBI agents shot and killed an armed Utah man accused of making violent threats against President Biden hours before the president was expected to arrive in the state. California Senator Dianne Feinstein's recovering at her San Francisco home after taking a fall. ABC's Jay O'Brien.
Her staff is calling this hospital visit a precaution. They say the fall was minor, and then they go on to say all of her scans were clear, saying that Senator Feinstein is back home.
The 90-year-old Democrat is the oldest member of Congress. Gene Smith, the athletic director at The Ohio State University, says he will retire next summer. Daria Albinger, ABC News.
The Broadleys WOND Weather Center.
Mostly clear skies on tap this evening. Temperatures in the 70s. Luckily, it's not that humid, so we do have a beautiful summer Wednesday night to enjoy. Our low temperatures may drop to the mid to upper 60s heading into Thursday morning. Thursday, expect increasing cloud cover, breezy, turning more humid with high temperatures climbing back into the 80s. We can see a few hit or miss showers and storms during the late afternoon and evening hours. For Longport Media, I'm meteorologist Alexa Trischler.
WOND News time is now 7:32, and the current ocean water temperature is 72. Right now it's 83 in Pleasantville, 81 in Wildwood. Sunshine 82 on the world famous boardwalk in Atlantic City. I'm Scott Stevens, WOND News. Keep it here for more breaking news as it happens throughout the day. More of the Big Man's Report coming back next on News Talk 1492.3 WOND, South Jersey's News Talk leader.
WOND Pleasantville.
This fishing report is sponsored by Ray Scott Stock, 9211 Amherst Avenue in Margate.
It's time for Shep on Fishing with South Jersey's recognized authority on the world of fishing, Michael Shepard.
Hi, this is Shep on Fishing on Air, covering South Jersey from Fort Tescue to Long Beach Island and offshore. Here's what's going on. Summer fishing, it is a mid-season high, particularly with a lot of spot fish being caught along the beaches. Small hooks with small pieces of bait are catching them up and filling up the coolers. Summer flounder are liking minnow inshore along the beachfront, surf, in the inlets, and back bay channels. Striped bass are still strong biting eels, mainly at night. Sheep's head, tautog, and black sea bass are in the mix. On the other side of the spectrum, we are getting more reports about offshore big game fishing. For example, the 50th Ocean City, Maryland White Marlin Open is an East Coast highlight for blue water anglers. That event this week to Friday is putting up some awesome numbers. 400 boats registered, and the prize money, I think you have to go to their website to take a look at it to believe it. On opening day Monday, 220 and 19 blue marlin were released. There was one leaderboard change Tuesday when the Shooting Star out of Indian River put a 57-pound wahoo on the scales at Harbor Island, where the weigh-ins are open to the public. That's Jeff on for now. Summer fishing is super.
Catch the Shep on Fishing Show Saturday mornings at 7 on WOND, Tuesdays in sports, and daily in the press of AtlanticCity.com. Listen for his reports Tuesday through Sunday here on News Talk 1492.3 WOND.
Here's Robin Scott to describe what's going on at the Amherst Avenue Marina that provides resident and visiting fishers the complete Back Bay outdoor experience. Robin?
Thank you, Mike. We've been here since 1958, same family, owned, third generation. If you would like to work really hard at recreational fishing, buy your own boat. If you would like to enjoy recreational fishing at its very best, come here and rent one of ours, because we have a big fleet. They range from 15.5-foot Boston Whalers up to pontoon boats, and we do guided charters of the Back Bay. Now, the Back Bay is important because people don't get seasick. You have to be over 18, and you have to have a valid car driver's license. We provide rods, reels, bait, tackle, and ice. You can find us at 9211 Amherst Avenue in Margate. Our phone number is 609-822-6819. Email rayscottstock@comcast.net. The website is rayscottstock.com.
Hi, this is Ray Scott Bonner, third generation operator of Ray Scott Stock. Our hours are 7 to 5 during the week, 6 to 6 on the weekends, and 6 to 6, 7 days a week, Memorial Day to Labor Day. Book your boat now at rayscottstock.com.
Broadleaf Plumbing, Heating, and Air Conditioning is ready to keep you cool. Join their family comfort plan for peace of mind all summer long and same-day service when you need it. Thinking about a new AC system? Upgrade with no money down and 0% financing for 7 years. Plus rebates and tax credits on select equipment. Don't wait for your system to break down. Call Broadleaf today, your local factory-authorized Bryant dealer at 609-390-3907 or visit broadleaf.net. Bryant, whatever it takes.
Oh, yeah.
On News 1400 and 92.3 WOND. I am your host, Blake Rozelle. Thank you all for tuning in to the second half of the hour here. We'll get back to the program in just a second. But before I do, I always like to thank my wonderful sponsors who make this show possible. Angelo's Fairmount Tavern. Dinners, banquets, weddings, and catering of Atlantic City, a staple celebrating 87 years of dining excellence. If you're ever in the area, if you're here for a weekend, if you're in the Atlantic City area, stop on into Angelo's Fairmount Tavern for a delicious meal. And again, contact Angelo about banquets, weddings, catering events, anything, you name it. Angelo's got you covered. Tell him the big man sent you. Maz's Farm Market, an Italian coffee house on West Mill Road in Northfield. Maz's Farm Market has been a local treasure for South Jersey since the 1960s. Around 2011, the Clemente family took over and expanded the seasonal farm market into a year-round destination. Delicious coffee, deli sandwiches, freshly baked pies, anything you can imagine. Gino has it right there for you on deck in Maz's Italian Farm Market and Coffee House. Stop on in and see Gino for a discount. Tell him the big man sent you. Castle Supermarket of Margate for all the delicious bakery goods, the deli items, everything fresh and delicious, always, every day. Stop and get your items and groceries, household items at Castle Supermarket of Margate for you on the island. Tell Howard I sent you. Aversus Bakery, everything is fresh daily. Again, catering for all occasions. You can order online, and it's always available. Delicious homemade Italian sandwiches, dishes, desserts, Italian spreads, pastries, some of the best Italian cakes around. Stop on in Aversus for a wonderful lunch experience or a meal. You can bring home meatballs, whatever you want for Sunday dinner at Aversus Bakery, South Jersey All Sports of Northfield. Boxing classes, indoor rentals, an all-new turf line facility. Stop on in South Jersey All Sports on 1225 West Mill Road in Northfield. Blaise Shemaskis Training Academy of Northfield. Call for all classes for boys and girls, birthday parties, tumbling classes, Ninja Warrior classes. Stop on in and see Tracy if you have any questions about any classes you'd like to sign up for or hosting your child's birthday party as well. And last but not least, Thomas C. Rozelle, attorney at law, defense attorney. Stop on in and see my dad, is well known for any legal matters. Hopefully you're staying out of trouble. But if you get into trouble, email tcrlaw@gmail.com for all legal services provided. And now let's get back to the show here on News Talk 1400 92.3 WOND. Back to the program with my main man, Sonny Marinelli. He's an actor. He's playing some great films. And we're just talking a little bit about acting here on the program tonight. Sonny, I wanted to thank you for coming on again the show. I really appreciate you coming on.
Thanks, Blake.
So we've had a good conversation about growing up in the acting world. You grew up in New York, you know, in kind of like one of the staples, the center of attention in New York City, as we said, for acting and show business and entertainment. And you shared a lot with me about, you know, some of the people that inspired you, some of your first days on the set of acting. But what I think a lot of people, especially, they don't really know what goes into it, especially if you're not an actor and you don't really know the big picture, no pun intended there. But if you don't know what it is to get into acting, you know, you have to explain a little bit about what it, you know, when you're actually on the set and all that takes when you're on, you know, shooting for a movie. So I heard these days are long. I spoke with some other actor friends of mine, and there's some long, tedious days. Am I right, Sonny, on that?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'll bring up Chaz Palminteri again. Chaz coined it perfectly. He said, acting is the easiest, hardest job you'll ever have, right? yeah, it's long days. Remembering dialogue, people take that for granted. They don't realize when they're watching a movie that those actors had to remember that dialogue, all of it, and spit it out like, you know, like it was their own. It's exhausting, and it's mentally exhausting. And I mean, my longest day was 18 hours, but I've done a lot of night shoots. And, you know, if you're it's 4 a.m. and you're up, you know, 20 hours and you're tired and you have to do a heavy scene and you stink it up. And you can't tell people, hey, man, I was bad in that scene because, you know, I was up 20 hours, man. I mean, what do you want from me? You know, there's no disclaimers. You know, you got to show up.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter how many hours you're working. You can't rest. And if you don't mind, I just want to tell a quick story. I was on my first TV series. Yeah, I was on my first TV series, and it was a male heavy series, and there were four leads, and I was one of the four leads. And it's 3 a.m, and we're there all day, and we're tired. We're drinking coffee, smoking cigarettes, what happened? And it was a heavy scene up next. So in between camera setups, that's movie talk, by the way, camera setups. You know, they set up the cameras in a different room, and we're laughing and goofing around. We have this heavy scene coming up, and we're overtired, we're delusional, the main producer, who was Bobby Maresco, I mentioned before, comes down and says, what are you guys doing? And we said, well, we're just, you know, having some fun. Well, you're shooting a TV series, okay? And about 12 million people are going to be watching this. So I would get your stuff together, okay, and go in another room and prepare for the next scene. Because you forget that you're shooting a movie. You forget that all these people are going to be watching you sometimes because you're there so many hours and you're tired and you just go in there and you spit the lines out and you walk away and you look at it and you go, I was horrible. Right. So you have to have laser focus. You can do what you want offset. But again, between when you walk on that set, you have to have laser focus. I don't care if you're up 24 hours. Have a little more coffee if you need it.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's mentally exhausting. and sometimes it could be monotonous because you're doing the same scene over and over and over and over and over. Right. Different takes, different angles, but you have to keep it fresh. It has to be like the first time you said it every time. And the proof is, you know, the proof that acting is difficult is that, man, put on Netflix or Amazon and you'll have actors that you've never seen before from like Iceland that'll blow you away. And then you watch a show and go, oh my God, these actors are horrible. It's hard to do. It's hard to be good. And, you know, and again, between action and cut, if you don't deliver, your career's over. You're done.
Yeah. So it seems to be a pretty, I don't know if I want to use the word cutthroat, but it seems to be pretty intense, right? Like, you know, I think it's just, we look at it if you're on the outside or, oh, you know, it's fun. We're going to, and don't get me wrong, I'm sure it is fun. You probably had many great stories about some good laughs fantastic. You shared. Yeah, laughs you shared on the set and some good memories you share on the set. But also it's the other side of it too, where the average person, you know, would have no idea of what really goes into it because they're just there to see the big moment when it appears on Netflix, when it appears in theaters or on Prime Video. That's what they're looking forward to. But that year of filming, if I'm correct, a year or so of filming or 6 months, whatever it takes, is not easy, you know?
I was on a movie recently and this background actor, he just showed up and he was a friend of a friend and they said they'll give him a line, you know, because he was really right for this guy with one line. And he was so excited, wanted to be an actor. And we were there 10 hours and he kept saying, when are we going home? No, it's first day. When are we going home? But that's what happens. You know, people want to go home. It's a lot of hours. And if, you know, you're shooting 5 days a week and you're leading the show and you don't have time to do much else. But, you know, that's why you have to love it. I adore this work. So, you know, I've shot in beautiful cities, Montreal, all over the world. And I've shot in Canton, Mississippi with a population of like 1,000 people. And I just love it. I love wherever they send me, and I love being on set. You have to love it.
Oh, yeah. And this is definitely a profession where it can be very rewarding. I mean, you get a lot of notoriety and publicity, obviously, being a big time actor. But the other end of that is too, it's a ton of hard work that goes into it, like you said, you know, but the hard work pays off, kind of like with anything. And that's something that you can token yourself to, is, you know, you work very hard and you continue to work very hard at what you do to keep yourself appearing in different films, right? Because you have to get calls from directors of these films that, hey, do you want to appear in my film? Right. So if they see your work and they see your demo reel, is that how you get noticed for other films?
Sure. Demo reel, when you start getting some work under your belt, and, you know, auditioning, and that's another whole animal, auditioning, preparing for that, because you get one shot. But Blake, look, you have to prepare for your show, right? You're really good at this. And I know you do a ton of preparation. And if you don't, you're not going to have a show anymore. It's any job. You have to love it and you have to put the work in. And if you don't, you're just going to, you know, fall to the back of the line and end up getting another job. So, and it's the waiting, right? You know, we're all on our way up, and the waiting for an audition, the waiting for a call, having a great audition, not getting it over and over and over, and wondering why, and just still getting up out of bed and, you know, showing up for the next audition and working even harder. We all have to put the work in if we want to do stuff that most people don't do, like having a radio show. That's hard.
I appreciate it. Yeah, it does. It's a lot of work that goes into it, you know, understanding the guests and learning a little bit about their life, and then bringing them on and asking the right questions. But I want to talk a little bit about, you know, first I want to talk about what the acting world was like during the pandemic and how you kind of made it through the pandemic in your career. And I want to talk about some films that you've appeared in, you know, some recent films or some other films with some well-known films that, you know, may have been played many times that everyone's heard of, with some other actors as well. But what was it like, either filming through the pandemic, or if was there a dead period during COVID for those few years there? And how did you suffice, and how did you kind of get through that as an actor?
I was out of work for about a year and change. And, you know, it wasn't as bad, because not that there's misery in company, but I just knew that it wasn't my career that was suffering. Nobody was working, right? So I said, okay, no one's working. So we probably weren't supposed to do this, but it's 3 years out, and me and some of my actor friends would get together and just riff. You know, we just like improvise and do acting exercises and just shoot ourselves doing stuff just to keep, doing what we do. Just because I knew it might be a year, 2 years, 3 years, I didn't want to show up on set really rusty. So a couple of friends and myself, we just, you know, a couple of days a week, we just get together and throw the camera on and just, you know, improvise, or just write some short scenes, or do scenes from plays in my apartment, you know, just screw around just to stay loose. I exercised like crazy because all the gyms were closed, and I read probably 20 acting books in that time between books and audiobooks. I was walking in the park and every day and just listening to audiobooks and caught up on some old books I forgot about. And yeah, I stayed with it. And I am getting a movie the second March of the pandemic. I ended up getting a movie, and I was in Mississippi for like 4 or 5 weeks. So it worked out well for me.
That's great. So yeah. So you had to stay fresh. You had to stay kind of fluid. And with your acting and remembering lines and all that stuff. And also, like you said, well, not just staying in shape for your health, but also staying in shape for parts in a movie, right? You want to, I know a lot of actors try to keep their best figure, right? When it comes to being on screen, you know, working out's a huge part in health, right?
It really is. And just for your face alone. I mean, if you you're drinking alcohol a lot and you're not working out, eating bad food, you know, I mean, unless you're playing like Jake LaMotta in his latter years, you know, you don't want to be bloated. You don't want your big bags under your eyes and you know, then it just, you don't want to do that. You want to be fresh when you show up, unless you're playing a character that's an alcoholic. You want to be fresh and you want to carry yourself. It's also exhausting. So you need to be in physical shape to put all those hours in.
Right. Absolutely. So, you know, you and like many other actors kind of stayed fresh during the pandemic. You guys really kind of you rehearsed your lines, you shot some things on camera, and that's great that you're able to get that part in that movie in that March you were saying. So let's talk about some of these movies a little bit that you, you've appeared in a lot of things here. I'm looking at your resume. What are some big movies that you enjoyed having a role in? Some great people that you met, kind of like you mentioned some things before about Chaz Palminteri and your interactions with him. But and I believe you were also in Entourage.
Yeah, I was in the series and the movie.
Yeah.
Two different characters.
Kevin Dillon was in that as well.
Yes, and interestingly enough, about a couple of years prior to Entourage, I was in a TV series, a CBS show called That's Life with Kevin Dillon. So I spent about 8 months with Kevin. We played, he was my brother-in-law on the show. We were good friends. And then when I got to Entourage, it was great, you know, seeing him.
Uh-huh. So did you have some great memorable moments from working with some of these actors, or what was one of your favorites that you appeared in that you want to talk about, that you enjoyed?
There were two obscure movies that I did a few years back. And one was, I'm bringing his name up again. One was directed by Chaz Palminteri. It's called Noel. And it's just such a beautiful movie. Penelope Cruz and Alan Arkin and Robin Williams, Paul Walker, Susan Sarandon. It's just a really beautiful movie. It's about loneliness and how loneliness can crush people in different ways. And it's really a beautiful script. Very interesting. I played Paul Walker's partner. We were cops. And I get, you know, it's very sad Paul passed, but I spent a lot of time with Paul. He's just a great guy. And I just, an obscure movie with that big cast. It still plays every Christmas because the movie takes place around Christmas time. Yeah. And I did another bit of an obscure movie. It's a mob movie called 10th and Wolf. Now, you might know that because that's down in Philly.
I was going to ask you about that, Sonny. That movie was filmed in Philadelphia. South.
Yeah, well, actually, we filmed it in Pennsylvania, believe it or not. We couldn't get Philly, so we used Pennsylvania. And, what a cast. I mean, if you look at the cast list in that movie, it's pretty amazing. And, God, and that was directed by Bobby Moresco. I had mentioned him before. He's directed me in theater a bunch of times. And that's a really good movie. It has an underground fan base, and I go to a lot of different places. Interestingly enough, people recognize me from 10th and Wolf because the people who are fans love the movie. And in fact, Chris Mormondo, who just directed me in a movie, you know Chris, he's a big fan of 10th and Wolf. And so when we worked together, he knew me from that movie. If you haven't had a chance, and the movie I did in March on Pandemic, that's a period piece. That was fun because I played a Southerner from 1810 Mississippi, historic character, true story. And that was just a blast playing this guy from 1810. Really, really want to talk about being terrified taking on a role. I was really scared, but that I had a lot of fun on that film also.
That's great. And the 10th and Wolf movie, I was going to ask you about that, cause I know that's like right in our backyard here. They're based out of South Philadelphia, but you said it was filmed in Pennsylvania. So that's pretty neat.
I'm sorry. Pittsburgh,
Pennsylvania. I'm gonna post that on my social media because I want my audience to go check out that movie. I did a little bit of it before. I put some pictures of the scenes up there. I think Giovanni Ribisi is in that movie, and he's appeared in a lot of movies.
Giovanni Ribisi and Dennis Hopper was in that movie. Brian Dennehy. It's just a good full cast of Dash Mihawk and James Marsden, who's huge today. He really blew up since then. And it's a good movie, man. It's really told well. It's a good movie.
Yeah, that's great. I'm going to post that for my audience and also a lot of other your works too, to go out and check out. What was some of the, you know, we have a few minutes here in the program, but what were some other things that, or some other roles that you played that was maybe a role that you felt uncomfortable playing at first that you really, I know you mentioned the Mississippi movie, but was there some other movies as well where you said, man, how am I going to bring this character out of me? You know, did you feel uncomfortable playing it? And was it really hard to, which one was the hardest to play in your opinion that you didn't feel that comfortable doing it at first?
Of course, the Mississippi movie, because it was playing some Southerner and period, and it was just really frightening. But honestly, there was a movie I did, it was called Rosewood Lane. Rose McGowan and I she played my girlfriend in the movie. And I had to play this guy that was so far removed from me. His name is Barrett Tanner, and he was this really quiet, brainiac lawyer, sort of a passive man, you know. And the director just really liked me. He offered me this lead in this movie with Rose McGowan. I was thrilled. But honestly, I mean, even now when I watch the movie, I couldn't grasp it. I just, I did my best. I just couldn't get a hold of that character. I don't know why. I tried my best, and it never happened to me. I always get in the ballpark, at least. And I look back now, and I look at that movie, and I'm like, I cringe because I don't think I was very good in it. I just couldn't grasp this guy, you know? And I would pray every night that the movie wouldn't see the light of day because I knew I wasn't getting it, you know? So luckily, it was only one. Luckily, it was only one. But I think we all have, I think every actor has that one that gave us some black and blues, you know?
Yeah. And that comes with being in the acting world. Like, you never know what you're going to be offered some roles to play, and they may make you feel uncomfortable, or some roles you're like, oh, I definitely want to, you know, I want to hop right on that role. I want to be in that role. You know, something, maybe something you feel like it's down your alley. Right.
Yeah. And I still want a shot. I want to go back and redo that movie again. It was 12 years ago, but I want another shot at it. But I think I can get it this time. You know,
is there anything that you're working on currently that you're allowed to disclose to the audience, or some things that maybe.
Sure. Yeah. I have three. I know you have running late. I have three movies that are going to be released. And, one is called Jersey Bread. We shot that in Jersey in Asbury Park. Okay. And I have another one called Mississippi Scholar, where I play a high school teacher. This one, I really feel really good about. That should be, they should be released probably by maybe next spring. And I have another movie called Judge No Book, and Chris Mormondo directed that.
Yeah.
That was fantastic. We just
shout out to Chris Mormondo. He's great.
Oh, yeah, man. He's a beast. He's a beast of a talent, Chris. He really is.
Yeah. I had the opportunity of doing the interview with him in person. He was actually down this way in South Jersey back in early June, and I met him in person. Terrific guy, and really, really good guy. And we had a great time on the show, and we went out afterwards, and it was a blast. We went to dinner, and he's a really good guy.
He's bigger than life. He really is. Yeah. He's got such a great personality. I love Chris, and he offered me a movie. He was nice enough to offer me the role without auditioning. So I have those three that are going to be released this year. So things are going pretty well. We're on strike now, of course. So we're a bit, you know, on hold till the strike is over. But I don't think it's going to last very long. We're doing really well. SAG is really showing some cojones, you know what I mean? And people are realizing that, that, you know, we have a right to get what we want. So I feel pretty good that the strike should be over, hopefully by, you know, September or so.
Oh, that's good news looking down the road that everyone can kind of, actors can kind of get work back and kind of getting out of this, the strike that's in there right now. But, you know, it's got to be tough on you guys. And you know, hopefully it all works out, like you said, within September and a few more weeks. But where could some of these movies be viewed that you're going to be releasing in another year or so? Is it Netflix, Amazon Prime?
Probably Netflix and Amazon Prime. I'm assuming. We don't know because, you know, we had that to be sold. Mysterious Circumstance, that's the movie I did, the 1810 Mississippi piece, the true story. That's called Mysterious Circumstance. And that's on Amazon Prime.
Okay.
Right now, that was released a couple of months ago on Amazon Prime, and it's doing fairly well. A really interesting story about Lewis and Clark, the first guys who went out to California, and some real, real shady stuff went on in politics back then. So I think people might like that one. And you know, the other three, we have to sell the movies to see who's going to buy them.
Right. Yeah. That one about Lewis and Clark expedition. That's very interesting, and I'll look into that one as well. I'll put that one up for our viewers. But I know we're tight on time here, and you have to get going. But Sonny, I really appreciate you coming on tonight. And this was a great show, great interview, and I'd like to definitely do it again in the future. Have you on?
I'd love to. You ask really good questions, and questions that actors like to talk about, like myself. I like talking about the stuff you brought up. So interesting. I really had a good time. Like,
yeah, and maybe we can do some collaborations in the future together. We can meet in person
anytime.
One day you're on the East Coast, and we'll set it up.
I'd love to do it.
Well, you've been listening to News Talk 1400 here at 92.3 WOND. I am your host, Blake Rozelle. Check out Sonny Marinelli on his Instagram, Facebook, and his website, IMBD, and all his movies. And we'll be here next week on the Big Man's Report Live. Tune in, and everyone have a great weekend, and stay safe. Thank you, Sonny.
Thank you.
Live and local radio you can depend on.
News Talk 1400 at 92.3 WOND, South Jersey's News Talk Leader.
W223CO Atlantic City. WOND, live from the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino Atlantic City Studio.